Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Well, tonight as we're opening up this series on the end times, I want you to open your Bibles to the book of Acts, Acts chapter number 2. As you open there, I want to read to you a quote that I thought was very impacting. I like a good quote every now and then. I thought this would be a great way to start off this series on the end times. A man by the name of Tillotson, I hope I said that right, but it said this: "He who provides for this life, but takes no care for eternity, is wise for a moment, but a fool for forever." Let me read that to you again. "He who provides for this life, but takes no care for eternity, is wise for a moment, but a fool forever." Now, when we talk about the end times, we've got to ask a couple of questions. First of all, is what are the end times? You know, we've heard a lot of things about that. In recent days, maybe you've been watching the news and you've seen things like the blood moons. Maybe you've heard about teachings happening in different places, things that are going on. There's been movies made about the end times, the end of the world. In fact, it's a very big thing, very popular. It sells a lot of books, sells a lot of movies. My wife and I, we started a movie series just the other day. We were sitting in the second part of it. And we looked at each other and we thought, oh my goodness, what did we get ourselves into here? You know, it's kind of like, this is creepy, this is weird, we did not sign up for this. And yet, this whole apocalyptic type thought is on the minds of many people. Lots of things happening. You can just watch the news and you can know that stuff is going on in the world. The world is in turmoil. Jesus called it the birth pains. There's things, waves of things, just like a woman who's travailing in birth, that those pains get increasingly worse and worse as the birth gets closer and closer. Our world is experiencing these same birth pains. Things are getting more and more intense, and things are happening faster and faster. You look around, you see things like tsunamis, earthquakes. People are getting trapped in caves underground. There's all sorts of stuff. The tsunamis that hit both Japan as well as the Philippines. Things that are taking place, wars and rumors of wars. Radical militant groups raising up all over the world, taking people and doing things that are horrific. Things that should not be done. And all of us in this place tonight need to recognize and realize that there is going to be a time and a day that Jesus comes back. Jesus himself spoke of this. Jesus talked about it. It was prophesied. That the Lord is the beginning and the end. God is the creator, but God is also the finisher of the work. And the Bible tells us that Jesus is coming back, and we're going to take a look at some scriptures tonight that talk to us about the end times and what's going to happen. I had you turn with me to Acts chapter number 2. Acts chapter number 2, and I want to read verse number 16 all the way through verse number 21. The Apostle Peter, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit is poured out on the church. Men come together and women and all the children and people of the area, they're all there for the day of Pentecost and the Holy Spirit's poured out on the church, and now here they come out and they, you know what happened, they start speaking in tongues, start speaking in other languages. People hear the works of God in their own native language, their own native tongue. And as they do, they hear these people and they hear the wonderful works of God, and some people say, well, these guys got to be drunk. Listen to them, they're babbling. The apostle gets up and he starts to tell them, hey, nobody's drunk here. It's too early in the morning and we're not like that. And he says, verse number 16, but this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Verse number 17, and it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. Verse number 18, and on my men servants and on my maidservants, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. They shall speak forth the word of God. Verse number 19, and I will show wonders in the heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. Verse 20, the sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. Verse 21, and it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. As we see the end times coming, and as we see things happening on the earth, as we see the signs in the heavens, things taking place, we need to call out to our God. We need to call on the name of the Lord, and we need to endure to the end, because he who endures to the end will be saved. Very important for us to keep these things in mind. Now, in the New Testament, Jesus Christ's second coming is mentioned 300 times. That would mean one in every 25 verses deals with the end times. Do you think that's important for us to understand? Think that's important for us to know about? We need to get an understanding of this. I was shocked as I was studying for these messages and putting together some outlines and different things like that, how many scriptures I have read over and didn't even realize that it's reminding us and telling us and getting us equipped and prepared because Jesus is coming back. Scriptures that we would all use, scriptures that we would all quote, scriptures that we would say and use each and every day for other reasons, and yet woven into the fabric of our New Testament Christianity and thought and what our life should be like should be woven in an understanding of the end times, that Jesus is coming back and he's coming soon. Now let me say this to you, I'm gonna put this statement up on the overhead. Jesus is really coming back. Hallelujah. It's real. It's not figurative, it's not interpretive, it's not, an image, it's not a picture, it's literal and it's not figurative. In other words, God is not mixing words saying Jesus is gonna come back and we're gonna miss him because he's not really coming back in his person. No, it is a literal return of the Lord. Jesus will come back. It's the second advent, the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's coming again and he's coming to get us. He's coming so that we can be with him forever and ever. What a glorious day that's gonna be. Yes, great and awesome and terrible when you take a look at the signs and the wonders and the things that are gonna come upon the earth. Some of the things that you can see in the Bible, and yet we can comfort ourselves that Jesus is coming for his own. John chapter 14, you're there in Acts, turn one book back to John chapter number 14. Let's take a look at this together. John chapter number 14. Verse number 2 and verse number 3. Jesus is speaking. If you have a red letter Bible edition, you'll see that these are the words of Jesus in red. John chapter 14, verse number 2. Jesus is speaking. He says, "In my Father's house are many mansions." Some of your translations say many rooms. "If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." See, Jesus went up to heaven. And just like the parables, he stayed away a long time, according to earth time, millennium, if you will. But he says he went away, why? So that he could go prepare a place for each and every one of us who would believe on his name for salvation. Verse number 3, look at what he says. "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." See, Jesus is gonna come back once again. Jesus is going to come back and wrap this thing up for us. Jesus is gonna come and he's gonna get us. Acts chapter 1, you don't have to turn there unless you want to. Verse number 11, the angels are speaking after Jesus has ascended into the clouds and disappeared from the sight of the apostles. And the angels start speaking and they say, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into the heaven." In other words, the same way Jesus just floated up into the heavens, Jesus is going to come right back down onto the earth once again. It is literal. It is not figurative. Now, I have to say this about the end times. Jesus himself spoke of this, and that is that no one knows the exact day or hour that Jesus will return. Everybody tells you, "I know when Jesus is coming, I can tell you the hour and the day." You can say, "No, you don't." According to the Word of God. You're a false prophet if you're going to tell me the hour and the day. I'm not going to follow that. I'm not going to believe that. No one knows the exact time that Jesus is going to come back. Jesus himself even said it. Matthew chapter 24, you're there in John. Turn back to Matthew this time. Chapter number 24. Matthew chapter number 24 and verse number 36. Once again, Jesus is speaking. He's talking about the end times, talking about the things that are going to take place in Jerusalem, talking about the signs and the things that are going to happen. And look at Matthew chapter 24, verse 36. He says, "But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only." Jesus said the Son doesn't even know. Now, some people have said, "Well, then he can't be God because he doesn't even know." And yet, Jesus so submitted himself to the human experience, and he was God in the flesh. And therefore, the Father knows the day and the hour. And the Son has submitted himself to the will of the Father. That's why he learned obedience by the things which he suffered while he was here on the earth. Went to the cross, and now he's ascended on high at the right hand of the Father. There will come a day, there will come an hour when the Father looks to Jesus and says, Son, it's time for you to go back and get your own. Go and get him. And Jesus will raise up from the throne the right hand of power, and he will come back, and the trumpet will sound. The eastern sky will split, and Jesus is coming for each and every one of us. No one knows the day or the hour. Now, having said that, even though no one knows the day, and even though no one knows the hour, the Bible is clear that we can know the times and the seasons. Very clear. Very clear. You're there in Matthew. Turn me to the book of Luke. Let's take a look at it once again. This time, Luke's Gospel, chapter 21. Tonight, we're taking mostly a look at the words of Jesus about the end times. Jesus is coming back. No man knows the day or the hour, but we can know the times, and we can know the seasons. Luke chapter number 21. I'm going to read a lot of scriptures, but I believe you guys can handle this. I believe that you guys are ready for this. In Luke chapter number 21, we're going to start in verse number 25 and read through verse number 33. He's just got done. He's talking to the disciples, telling them about the things that are going to come to pass in Jerusalem. Now he starts talking about the end of the age. Luke chapter number 21, starting verse number 25, he says, and there will be signs in the sun, in the moon, and in the stars, and on the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. Now, how many of you guys have followed current events in the past couple of years? Okay, this should sound very familiar to us all. There are signs in the sun. Things have been happening. I don't know if you remember a couple years back where they were concerned about a solar flare that was so big that it could literally lick up and wipe out the earth. You guys remember that? Okay, some of you guys remember that. Signs in the moon. Four blood moons all together, right? People are freaking out because each and every one of those blood moons also coincides with a Jewish festival and a Jewish holiday. You think God is trying to get our attention? Think God's trying to tell us something? Think God's trying to show us something? And in the stars and on the earth, distress of nations. You don't have to look very far to find distress of nations. Hundreds of girls kept captive in Africa. All the stuff that's going on in Iraq and Syria, things that are taking place, all sorts of stuff that's happening. People are concerned about radical militant groups that are rising up and beheading people and accosting people and doing all sorts of horrible things that should not be done. There is distress in the nations. Nations are going bankrupt. World systems are crumbling. Things are taking place with perplexity. The sea and the waves roaring. We already mentioned the two typhoons, the tsunami that happened, then typhoon that just came over the Philippines. One of our missionaries, Mike Keyes, sent us pictures of the devastation. Churches where there wasn't one stone left on the other. There wasn't a single brick that was left on the other. They're rebuilding now and trying to continue the good work that they were already doing. But that typhoon literally wiped this impoverished nation out. There are signs of the times going on all around us. Let's read on. In the next verse, verse number 26, it says, men's hearts failing them from fear and the expectation of those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken. See, things are shaken up all around us. But thank God that we serve an unshakable God. And he's brought us to an unshakable kingdom. And therefore, we don't have to have fearful hearts where the expectation of judgment coming on the earth would shake us. No, we can lock into Jesus and we can hold on to an unshakable God, for our future is secure in him. One of my relatives was telling me about a relative of theirs who, after 9/11, was just so fearful that they took up smoking, and they were just so worried that they just always had a cigarette in their hand because of 9/11. See, the expectation of fearful judgment, things taking place on the earth, the distress that's coming on the earth, is causing people to have stresses in their life where they'll do anything to get away from it. Take a look at verse 27. Look at this. Then. then. In other words, all this stuff is going to happen. You're going to see all these signs and wonders taking place. The distresses, the nations, the waves, the moon, the sun, the stars. All this stuff is going to go on. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Remember what the angel said. The angel said, in the same way you saw him go up, you're going to see him coming back down. So here Jesus himself declares, then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Verse 28. Now when these things begin to happen, here's our encouragement. Because why? They've already begun. We can see them plainly. When these things begin to happen, look up and lift up your heads because your redemption draws near. We can get excited, church. You know, looking at the news, it can get so depressing and it can be so distressing. And yet, when we see those things happening, when we see things going on, yes, we should have hearts of compassion. We should be moved for our brothers all over the world. We should be moved for the innocent and the lost that are going through these struggles and these trials. And we need to pray for the nations. We need to pray as we see those things going on the earth. We need to believe God for an end time harvest. We need to believe God that God will send laborers into the harvest fields for their ripe. There are people that are suffering and need to hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. But we don't need to be discouraged. We don't need to be fearful. We don't need to be afraid. We need to lift up our heads because our redemption draws near. Jesus is coming for you and he's coming for me. Let's read on. Verse number 29, then he spoke to them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. Now in the Bible, if you did a quick study of what the fig tree is, you'll find that the fig tree actually represents national Israel. So he says, take a look at the fig tree, and then trees in the Bible represent peoples, represent nations. So he gives us a natural example here on the earth of something that in the spiritual is taking place. So he says, look to the fig tree and all the trees in the natural. Look at these trees. When they are already budding, you see and know for yourselves that summer is now near. In other words, you know by the budding of the trees that when they're already budding, summer's coming, right? Spring is on us. Now it's fruit-bearing season. That's going to happen in the summer. In the same way, we need to take a look at the nations around us, as well as national Israel, the fig tree. That's a very important key to the end times. If you can look at national Israel and see what's going on. See, years ago, Israel was not a nation, but they came back, according to the prophecies in the Bible, as a nation. And oh my goodness, everybody said, whoa. It's sooner than we thought. Jesus is coming back. Look at verse 31. So you also, when you see these things happening, know that the kingdom of God is near. Verse 32, assuredly I say to you, this generation will by no means pass away till all things take place. Verse 33, I love this. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. The word of the Lord endures forever. Come on, we can give the Lord a praise for that. That's our comfort. That's our comfort in this time. That is our, see, sometimes we ask, man, do I need to be afraid? I don't know. I read all this stuff about the end times. I saw this movie where things are coming up out of the ground and it had this weird looking horse head and a man and a stinger on the back of it. And, you know, I heard somebody talking about that's a helicopter and you know, the apostle couldn't have put to natural words what that was. But I just don't know what to think. I don't know if I should be afraid or not. Listen, you should never fear. You should never fear. You should never be afraid because heaven and earth may pass away. Stuff's going to happen on the planet. There's going to be hard times and distresses that come on the earth. There's going to be things that take place that should not happen. And yet, God is still good. Jesus is on the throne. Jesus is coming back. And even though heaven and earth may pass away, his word will by no means pass away. That's good news. For all of us. Last question for us tonight is this. Are we living in the last days? I think we already answered this question. But I want to mention to you guys this thought. that the last days are not only a future event, even though the last days are a future event, there's going to come a time where it is like we're wrapping this thing up. It's the last days, Jesus is coming back. But it's not only a future event, but it's also a present reality. Even if Jesus doesn't come back in our lifetime, I like what Tony Cook said, it's still our last days. It's someone's last days here on the earth. And all throughout the Bible, when you look at the scriptures, there were people that were waiting for the return of the Lord Jesus. And we are to live like Jesus is coming back today. Now, that doesn't mean you don't plan. That doesn't mean you don't save. That doesn't mean you don't use sound wisdom for the future. We can prepare and we can build and we can plant like Jesus is not coming back in our lifetime. But we should live ready and live like he's coming back today because we are living in the end times. And our redemption draws closer and closer every day. Every day we're closer to the return of the Lord. Jesus is coming back. And even if he doesn't come back in our lifetime, we are living in the last days. 1 John, turn there with me. 1 John, I'm going to show this to you in the Bible. As you get close to Revelation, you'll find 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. Go to 1 John chapter number 2. 1 John chapter number 2, we're going to take a look at verse number 18. First John chapter 2, verse number 18, he says, little children, it is the last hour. Look at that. This is the same John that wrote the Revelation. And that same John, thousands of years ago, is writing to people who believed in Jesus, people who were Christians. And he says, this is the last hour. See, we need to understand that we are living in the last days. You say, but wait a second, it's been thousands of years. Yeah, but it's still the last days. As you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. I want you to know something. I highlighted up on the overheads for you. Two times in the same thought, two times in the same verse, he says the same exact thing using the same exact words. It is the last hour. We need to get it in our minds that we are living in the last days. It is the last hour. Well, how do we know that it's the last hour? God's been waiting so long. It's been millennia. It's been centuries. Here's how we know. Antichrists have already risen up. We have seen genocides in Germany, in Africa, and now it's starting in the Middle East. We have seen the spirit of Antichrist, of these foul spirits that deny that Jesus is Lord. We have seen the destruction on the earth when men and women raise up who are opposed to the things of God and the destruction that they can do. And because of that, we know that it is the last hour. We are living in the last days, whether we like it or not, whether we want to be comfortable or not. Listen, I hope tonight, if anything, this gives us a holy discontent. And that it gets us a little uncomfortable, that we need to recognize and realize the urgency of the hour that we're living in. Because if we're living in the last days, and Jesus is coming sooner than we know it, then there are people out there that are lost, and they're dying, and they're gonna go to hell unless we tell them that they don't have to go. Unless we share the gospel with them, unless we go after them. Listen, church, we need to stir ourselves and shake ourselves. We have a rescue mission 1 yard from hell's gates, and we need to be snatching people out of the fire, saving souls, and winning the lost to Jesus, and discipling them and raising them up in the house of our God. Oftentimes I've heard it asked, what if you knew that you only had this last day on the earth? What would you do? I've heard people that have said, well, you know, I would go out and I would tell everyone about Jesus. I knew, man. I just tell everybody. I'd go and I'd spend as much money as I could to tell people about. I wouldn't care if it was my last day. I would put it all in. I would do it all. Now, we understand that should Jesus tarry, you're still going to need to take care of your needs, take care of the needs of your family, that sort of thing. And don't be foolish. But at the same time, what is stopping us from telling someone about Jesus now? What's stopping us from urging somebody? You don't know when Jesus is coming back. No man knows the day, no man knows the hour, but we do know the signs, and we do know the seasons, and we are living in the last days. What's stopping you from calling that friend that you haven't seen in a long time and saying, hey, I just love you so much. I'm concerned about your eternal life. What's stopping us from calling our family members, our parents who are getting on in years? What's stopping us from calling our cousins? What's stopping us from reaching out to people who we love and urging them? That's why the Apostle Paul said, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we compel people. We go after them. We tell people. That's why at this church, we tell you the gospel. We tell you the truth. We've got sweat pouring down, veins popping out of our necks, spitting all over the place. Why? Because we know this is real. We know this is true. And there's an urgency on the inside of us that Jesus could come back at any minute. And if he doesn't, we are not assured tomorrow. And therefore, we need to know that we are living in the last days. Last scripture for today, Revelation. I thought it'd be cool to go into Revelation because we hadn't been there yet in this message. We'll get there. Going to take a look at some different things as we go throughout the series, the signs, the Antichrist, that sort of a thing. I know a lot of people have a lot of questions. And you know, maybe we'll do something where we just do a question and answer night. And that'd be kind of fun to do. A lot of great preachers and teachers. And, you know, we know in part and we prophesy in part. We don't know everything. But what we do know is from the Word of God. Revelation chapter 22. That's what you're going to get at this church. That's what you're going to get in this series. Now, there's a lot of opinions, a lot of books been written, a lot of stuff been said. And yet, I know what the Word of God has to say. Revelation chapter 22, verse number 7. Let's look at the words of Jesus once again. Revelation chapter 22, verse number 7. Jesus is speaking. He says, behold, I am coming quickly. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book. Remember, Revelation is a revelation of Jesus Christ. It reveals to us the eternal plan of God and his Son. And Jesus himself says, behold, take a look and see. I'm coming quickly. And you're blessed if you keep the words of this book. I'd like to take a moment and just make sure before we go any further, I believe that there are those of you in this place that if Jesus were to come back right now, that you wouldn't be ready. And I want to make sure that you're ready for the return of the Lord. I want to make sure that if this was the last day, that if after we closed up church, that moon rose, as we were looking, we heard the trumpet sound and the eastern sky split, and like lightning flashing from the east to the west where all could see. We'll know when Jesus comes. You don't have to wonder if you're going to miss it. You'll know that Jesus is coming back. And I want to make sure that your heart and your life is right with Jesus Christ. Now, you don't get right just by being good. A lot of people think if I can just be good enough, I'll make it to heaven. And yet nothing could be further in the from the truth. You don't get to heaven just by being good. There's no grading scale, no curve, no line you have to be above in order to be good enough, because the standard is perfection if we're going to make it there on our good works. And the only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. The Bible tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to get there just by attending church. Sometimes people think, well, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. And you were born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any of those other religions you were talking about. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindu. We're Christians. And yet, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you are raised in church, parents tell you you're a Christian growing up, that makes you a Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say sit in a church service and call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. That's like me saying I could go to my garage, call myself a car, and that makes me a car. It doesn't work. I'm just a guy sitting in my garage. Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. And I don't see anywhere in the Bible, nowhere, that by default, because you're not some other religion, that God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven and denying your presence in hell. Tonight, come on, let's talk about your eternal life. Sometimes people say, well, I'm going to go to heaven because, you know, I volunteered at my last church. I helped out. I sang in the choir. Made decisions. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to that church. It's great. I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible, could you? Where you get to go to heaven because you volunteered in church. It's not there. God's not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Sometimes people think, well, I know God. I know about God. I know about, Jesus and celebrate and sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. I celebrate the resurrection at Easter. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. I've studied the end times, and I know about what's going to happen. And yet, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you know who God is up here in your head, that you have mental assent towards God or know something about God or can quote scriptures or celebrate a holiday, that you get to go to heaven? If you'd read your Bible, you know that demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and believes he's the Son of God and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. And you can see what happens to the devil in the end. The book of Revelation, bound in chains and eventually cast into the lake of fire. Let's talk about your life. Jesus was speaking to a religious leader of his day. And they were talking about this very thing we're talking about, how to get into heaven. Jesus said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. It's just that simple. You want to go to heaven? When Jesus comes back, you want to go and be with him forever? You must be born again. Now, I know. Sometimes people turn off at this point. They say, ugh, born again? I have seen that on TV. I saw that in a movie. You know, I read about that on a blog on the internet or in a book, magazine, something like that. And that's weird. I don't want that. I don't want to have any part of that. And yet, if you don't have any part of that, then you don't have any part in heaven. Because Jesus said to enter, you must be born again. So obviously, it's not what the world is saying it is. Let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible define that for us. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. In the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, we were just reading out of, Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, that's pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people who are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. You know what Jesus is saying? He's saying, in or out. Either serve me or don't. Because if you think you're going to get in by playing the game, being lukewarm, you're not going to make it. I'm going to spit you out. Tonight, I want to make sure that when Jesus comes back for his own, that you're there with him, being caught up with him in the clouds, like the Bible says, that we can be caught up and go and be with him forever and ever. That's what you want. That's what I want. So how do we do that? Well, I'm going to give you an opportunity in a moment. If you need to do this, need to be born again, giving God all of your heart and all of your life, in a moment, I'm going to give you this opportunity by simply counting to three and pop my hands together. 1, 2, 3. And when I say three, I'll go bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. And should he come back in my lifetime, I'm going to go be with him because I've given him my all. Tonight, I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Say what? You're going to point and count at me? Pastor, if I do that, time out. I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be embarrassed. Well, let's get over that tonight, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Come on. And yet the devil thinks you're dumb, and he's trying to talk you out of it right now, trying to tell you this is just sensationalism. This is just emotion. You don't have to do this. You're fine. You're okay. What you've done is good enough. And yet we saw clearly that good works is not going to get us there. And that it's not about emotion. You know, in your heart of hearts, you know that this is what you need to do. Give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. Jesus said this. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father who is in heaven. I'm a man. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it, put it right back down. Probably won't even be embarrassed. But even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever. But on the opposite end of that statement, Jesus also said this. He said, if you deny me, I will deny you. Tonight, your call, your choice. Jesus is coming again. I don't know when. Could be tonight. Could be next year. Could be 1,000 years from now. But what's important right here, right now, is should he come back, are you ready? Will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? Who should raise their hand in a moment? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure? Tonight, make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand in this place if you're lukewarm? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. Get ready to get right with God. Getting your hand up in this safe and friendly place. Come on, let's get hot for Jesus tonight. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms that are both full, I can see you guys back there. Outside in the foyer, or if you're out there in the courtyard and you can hear the sound of my voice, get ready to raise your hand up. If you're at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, you can raise your hand up, tell an usher, or come into the church service right afterwards. Online, across the nation and around the world, watching, wherever you're at, God sees right where you're at. Distance doesn't matter to God. He's right there with you. Will you give him all of your heart and all of your life? If so, if you raise your hand, then right afterwards, minimize your browser, and you can click the blue button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage where it says how to know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Ready? If you need to do this, get ready to get your hand up. Here we go, all together on the count of three. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me. If that's you, you want to give God all of your heart, want to give God all of your life. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Thank you. Eight, nine. Thank you. 10, 11. Got you guys. 12 over here. 13. Thank you. 13 wise people already. 13. Anybody on this side over here? Anybody on this side? 14. Got you over there. God bless you. Who else tonight? Saying, I want to make sure. I just want to be ready for Jesus. I know if he comes back tonight, I wouldn't make it, but I want to make sure tonight. Anybody else real quick? We got about 14 wise people already. Anybody else that I did not already see your hand? Thank you, 15. God bless you. Who else tonight? Who else tonight? If that's you, just raise it up high when I'm looking your direction. Anybody else real quick? There's 15 wise people already. Listen, I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else real quick? Real quick, come on, raise it up high for me. If that's you, number 16, number 17, number 18. Let's go for God tonight. Come on, just lift it up high. Anybody else? Anybody else? If you don't know, come on, make sure tonight this is your night of salvation. Anybody else? Last call, and then I'm wrapping this thing up. All right, anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 15 wise people making sure tonight. But tonight I want to do things a little differently. I want to pray with you, okay? I don't want to embarrass you, but I do want to pray with you. And listen, we want to change destinies with you tonight. And if Jesus can walk a beaten, bloody mess to the cross, Calvary, public spectacle, tonight, if it's good enough to raise your hand for, it's good enough to come and receive. So I'm going to ask in a moment, everybody's going to stand, we're all going to give a clap and a shout, okay? No one leaves during this time. Very rude, the Holy Spirit's drawing people to himself up here. If you go that way, you're discouraging that. So let's encourage them and stay put. Let's offer our encouragement and clap and a shout. Those of you that raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand but you didn't, it's not too late. Once you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend, if you need a friend, get your kids. If your children raise their hand up in the family rooms, hey, bring them. They will remember this. They want to be ready for Jesus too, okay? And there's no restriction on age. Jesus says, let the little children come to me so they can come too. So let's all stand. And if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want to pray with you, but can't do that till we get you down here. So come on down right now. Come on down. Let's welcome them as they come.
Mercy stretch across my life.
They're coming. Come on, you can come too. Even if you didn't raise your hand, just get out of your seat. Get in the aisle and meet me up front.
You are good indeed. And I stand here in the midst.
Hallelujah, you can come too.
Your awesome majesty. For words cannot.
All right, they're still coming. They're still going. Come on, there's room for you too. You raised your hand, come on.
Your mercy stretch
come on.
Across my life.
If you didn't raise your hand, but you need to, come on.
I can see, and I know from experience, you are good.
Anybody else? Make it right to the front right now from the foyer. If you need to, come on down, come on down. They're still coming, come on, let's give them a hand. There's time. There's time, they're still coming. Right. Yes. Hey, you guys up front, put a big smile on your face. This is a good thing. This is not a bad thing. Don't have to be afraid. Jesus is about to come in and change everything from the inside. Gonna be brand new. Born again. That's what that means, being born again. It means you're going to be brand new. That old man is going into the grave, being nailed to the cross with Jesus. And now, just as Jesus was raised again to life, you're going to be raised up with him spiritually. A new man, new you, is coming out. I'm going to lead you in a prayer in a moment, okay? I want you to repeat this prayer out loud. Everybody else is going to join in with you to encourage you, okay? And we're going to say these words. It's a prayer. Prayer is just simply talking to God. And I want you to repeat this prayer out loud if you have the ability. Now listen, if you mess up on some of the words, it's okay. This is not a magical abracadabra thing. This is about your heart going before the Lord at this time. As we pray together, God's going to do a miracle in your life, and you're going to be born again, brand new. So let's all bow our heads and close our eyes. And I want you to say these words out loud to God. Say, Father God, I come to you now in the name of Jesus. I come to give you all of my heart and all of my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord and my Savior. Make me brand new, born again in you. Thank you, Jesus, for going to the cross just for me. Forgive me of all I've ever done wrong and wash me clean by your blood. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit that I receive now in Jesus' name. And let it be known that from this day on, I serve the Lord. I'm His. He's mine. I'm headed for heaven. Deny my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus, that on that day, when you come for your own, that you're coming for me. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. So, so cool. So cool. So exciting. You know what's neat? My dad, all right? My dad gave his heart to the Lord because he heard someone talking about the end times. And now decades later, here's his son who's leading people to the Lord because we were talking about the end times. Isn't that neat? You guys have a great future ahead of you. God wants to do some great things in your life. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine. See this guy waving at you over here? This is Pastor Joel, right? Like the prophet Joel we read tonight, okay? And Pastor Joel is a good guy. Nothing weird is going to go on. He's going to do a couple things with you guys, and then he'll let you come right back out in the church service, okay? He's going to give you some free information, some free literature to find out, now that I'm a Christian, what do I do next, okay? It's a little booklet our pastor wrote that'll help you to just get your bearings and find out, now that I'm a Christian, what do I do, okay? I'll give you a couple hints. Number one, hey, get back to church, all right? That's a great way to learn about the things of God. See, I'm spitting again. My goodness, I'm preaching. But that's a great way to get into the things of God is get back to church and get with people of like faith, which brings us to the second thing. He's going to talk to you about a program we have here. It's free, it's easy, and you need to do it. It's called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Can I describe it to you like this? It's a friend in church. We'll help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord so you don't go back to that old man that died and is in the grave, right? Now you go on with the new man, with the ways of God for your life. SPT is that friend who will encourage you and strengthen you. He'll describe how it works. Like I said, it's easy, it's free, and you need to do it. Now listen, let me make a promise to you guys. Give us a year, 1 year of your life here at the Rock Church World Outreach Center. Just sitting under teaching consistently here at the Rock under the Word of God. If you can make it to Sunday nights, hey, all right, consistently. Maybe you can come to Sunday morning and Sunday night, or Sunday night and Wednesday night, or you can come to the Women's Bible Study or the Young Adults Ministry. Whatever it is, get as much as you can consistently for the next year. And at the end of the year, here's the promise. You'll look around your life and say, my goodness, I didn't know that I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right. Hallelujah. Come on, take their word for it, all right? If you guys will make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel. He'll give you that free information and talk to you about the program, then he'll let you come right back out. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus, And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.